Captain America was created by Joe Simon and Jack Kirby. Cap made his first appearance in Captain America Comics issue 1 in March of 1941. In 1940, writer Joe Simon conceived the idea for Captain America and made a sketch of the character in costume. I wrote the name Super American at the bottom of the page, which is what Joe Simon said in his autobiography. He goes on to say, no, it didn't work. There were too many supers around. Captain America had a good sound to it. There weren't a lot of captains in comics. It was as easy as that. Captain America's sidekick Bucky was named after Joe Simon's friend, who was the star of the high school basketball team. Simon also recalled in his autobiography that Timely Comics publisher Martin Goodman gave him the go-ahead and directed that a Captain America solo comic book series be published as soon as possible, needing to fill a full comic with primarily one character's story. Joe Simon got his partner and friend, the infamous Jack Kirby, to pencil the book, and boom, the first issue of Captain America was born. The cover of the issue, as you have already seen, showed good old Cap punching Nazi leader Adolf Hitler in the jaw. The reason for this was because the issue was released around the time of World War II, so it showed an American soldier, i.e. Captain America, punching the douchebag Adolf Hitler in the jaw. The cover still remains one of the most meaningful and iconic covers, I'm going to say, not even in just comic book history, but magazine history in general. The issue also sold nearly 1 million copies. With his sidekick Bucky, Captain America faced Nazis, Japanese, and other threats related to the war. Stan Lee contributed to the character in issue 3. In the filler text story, Captain America foils the traitor's revenge, which introduced the character's use of his shield as a returning throwing weapon. Captain America soon became Timely Comics, now known as Marvel Comics' most popular character, and even had a fan club called the Sentinels of Liberty. In post-war era, the popularity of superheroes was fading, which ultimately led to the cancellation of Captain America comics with issue 75 in February of 1950. By then, the comic was primarily a horror book anyway. Cap was attempted to be brought back in 1954 with Captain America comics issue 76, but the attempt failed, ending at issue 78. Captain America would later make his triumphant return nearly a decade later in March of 1964 in one of the best issues in all of comic books, in my opinion, and that would be in Avengers issue 4. Following the success of Marvel's characters introduced in the 1960s, Captain America was recast as a hero haunted by his memories and trying to adapt in 1960s society. Now, I've been rambling about Captain America for a bit now, but have yet to tell you about his comic book origin. So guess what? After the outbreak of World War II in Europe, a young American patriot, Steve Rogers, was inspired to serve his country by joining the United States Army. When he attempted to enlist, Steve was rejected due to his skinny, anemic physique. However, he garnered the attention of certain people, including scientist Dr. Abraham Erskine, who was searching for suitable volunteers slash test subjects for a top-secret experimental program designed to create an army of super soldiers. As a result of Operation Rebirth, Steve Rogers gained speed, strength, flexibility, endurance, and agility of nearly superhuman levels. These heightened abilities, coupled with his unwavering courage and never-say-die attitude, eventually made him Captain America a living legend.
Spider-Man.
Superman.
Batman. Like, all the classics. You know what I'm saying? Batman's dope, man.
I can't stand that.
Spider-Man.
Superman.
Clark Kent.
What are the consequences for women when they are strong and when they are the central actors of their own lives?
Superhero, so she was irresistible. She was literally the only game in town.
She believed that you didn't need a man to take care of you, as she had her crush on Steve Trevor, but she didn't need him. He actually needed her.
Got him! Now to carry him back to my plane!
The early Wonder Woman are some of the most feminist stories in comics. When Wonder Woman emerged, women had to step out of the private sphere into the public sphere because we were at war.
Women did things they had never done before. They made planes, and they flew the planes, and they became superheroines. But as soon as the war ended, all the guys wanted their jobs back, and the women were sent back to the kitchen, and suddenly there was a mass amnesia, and no one remembered that women had ever been strong.
With Wonder Woman, you begin to see her adventures turn more to romance. She spent many, many, many years not being a feminist character at all.
It was like the perfect time for Wonder Woman to come back. And of course, when she came back in the new media, the media of the 70s, which was TV.
They did not think that a woman could carry a show. And, well, we proved them wrong and made a lot of money for the network, a lot of money.
I loved Wonder Woman growing up. I watched that television series. We twirled around and we thought that we might become Wonder Woman.
This is for the riot. The riot girl.
In time of war, it's typical, sometimes even useful, to demonize your enemy. We still see this today whenever a dictator or despot comes to power anywhere in the world. Caricatures and jokes, not always in the best of taste, rise to the forefront because it's our way of relieving aggression. So it was in World War II. Some people feared Adolf Hitler. Others mocked him. The Disney staff came up with the idea for a cartoon to be titled Donald Duck in Nazi Land, giving the all-American duck a nightmare that he was living in a country run by Nazis. The title changed when a song written for the cartoon by Oliver Wallace became a runaway hit and a now classic recording by Spike Jones. It then became essential to change the name of the cartoon to Der Führer's Face. It's easy to see why the film was so popular. It's very, very funny, reducing the serious tenets of Hitler's Nazism to slapstick absurdities. And it gave audiences a chance to think, as Donald does, about the freedoms they might have taken for granted.
Am I trying to be a citizen of the United States of America?
Der Führer's Face, directed by Jack Kinney, won the Academy Award as Best Animated Short Subject of 1943.
He is the master race. He hired right in the Führer's face. Not to love the Führer is a great disgrace. So he hired right in the Führer's face. When Herr Goebbels says we own the world in space, he hired right in Herr Goebbels' face. Then Hulk Göring says they'll never bomb this place. The hail, right in Herr Göring's face. Is he not the Superman?
Arion Führer Superman?
Yahweh is the Superman.
Super duper Superman. Is this Nazi land so good? Would you leave it if you could? Yeah, this Nazi land is good. We would leave it if we could. We bring the world new order.
Heere Hitler's world in order.
Everyone of foreign race, we love the poorest face, then we bring to the world disorder. Then the poorer says, we is the master race. We right in the poorest face, not to love the poor is a great disgrace. So we right in the poorest face. So we right in the poorest face.
Nix Kamalaus, into the closed get.
Yeah, Oh boy, I'm so hungry. Oh boy, oh boy, I'm so hungry.
Someone's rocking my dream boat. A rinky binky
just killing time till the island that inevitably turns up in this kind of picture inevitably turns up.
Someone's rocking my dream boat. I'm Captain Wet Up.
See? What did I tell you? The inevitable island. What a beauteous Garden of Eden. A veritable Shangri-La of flagrant beauty. A lustrous pearl of the Pacific. So peaceful. So quiet.
Everybody gets one.
Ice cream.
Well, that's that. Oh, just one minute, Joe. Just one minute, or you no get away from me. You wait.
I got the free one.
Believe me, sweetie face, it's a pleasure. Business is booming.
Well, everyone is asking the $64 question. Where is Fatso Goering? Your newsboy has it on good authority that Herman is soothing his jangled nerves at his hunting lodge in the Black Forest. Your correspondent also learned...
Black Forest. See, you know, I knew I should have made a left turn at Albuquerque. Black Forest, huh? Rabbitsaw. Pardon me, Doc, but might I inquire as to the route to Las Vegas?
Las Vegas? Las Vegas, sir. Let's see now. Las Vegas, sir.
Oh, yeah, I know. You take the road down to the first stop signal, turn left, and it's straight ahead. You can't miss it. Oh, yeah, yeah! Dankeschön! Las Vegas? Why, there is no Las Vegas in Germany! Germany? Yip! Yes, sir. Oh, that Schindler Schindgruber, that Schmierkäse Adolf, that Kippenskitten, that Schneckenpfeffer in der Grassenplatz. Oh, do I hate that Hitler Schwein, that phony Führer, that... Heil Hitler. So, wir machen einen Blitzkrieg an, aber Sauerhauten mit seiner Hand unter den Linden, mit Stammeln in der Backe, abpassen, Tümmer, Gluten, Fluten, Bluten, Toten, mit Ruten, Toten. So. Look, single-handed, I have captured that American rabbitzer, Bogsenheimer Bonnie. That's good, yeah. It's good, no? Yeah, it's good. I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you this genuine life guarantee diamond studded 14 karat gold decoration. Ach, Himmel! Ach, Himmel!
Does your tobacco taste different lately?
My friends, at this moment of sadness throughout most of the world, I want to talk with you about a number of subjects that directly affect the future of the United States. We are shocked by the almost incredible eyewitness stories that come to us, stories of what is happening at this moment to the civilian populations of Norway and Holland and Belgium and Luxembourg and France. I think it is right on this Sabbath evening that I should say a word in behalf of women and children and old men who need help, immediate help in their present distress, help from us across the seas, help from us who are still free to give it. Day and night, I pray for the restoration of peace in this mad world of ours. It is not necessary that I, the President, ask the American people to pray in behalf of such a cause, for I know you are praying with me. I am certain that out of the hearts of every man, woman, and child in this land, in every waking minute, a supplication goes up to Almighty God, that all of us beg that suffering and starving, that death and destruction may end, and that peace may return to the world. In common affection for all mankind, your prayers join with mine, that God will heal the wounds and the hearts of humanity.